It's a small world after all. It's a small world after all.
There can be only one.
They're here.
I have come here to chew bubblegum and kick ass. And I'm all out of bubblegum.
Go ahead. Make my day.
Cinema Royale.
Hello, welcome to Cinema Royale. I'm your host, Mike Mixtape. This is the podcast where we keep it classy most of the time. I am going to introduce you to my bros of cinema here, the Brotherhood of Cinema right here. First up, we've got Matt Bernales Knows Animat.
Hey, what's going on, mi hombres? ¿Cómo estás? Yo... Holy crap,
Matt,
I did it!
You're supposed to be speaking French.
Sí, señor. Cabrón. Hey, señor. Ay.
Lightning never strikes twice.
Spanish.
The winner of all of our challenges so far can't toss it into his mouth.
It's a big banana. I mean, how can you fit that all in at once?
That's what she said. And last but not least, we have James Sullivan, also known as Harvey Dude.
Tonight's broadcast is brought to you by the recent surge in Zelda porn searches. Thanks, Nintendo Switch.
Wow.
That was seriously a headline that I came across.
Oh yeah, I've seen that a few times.
I think the bigger story actually should be, I looked at the lineup of starting games that they have. I'm like, this is what you have to start with? You have such an amazing system here, and this is it? It's a small list of starting titles.
That's legit why I don't have a Switch right now, is because they got Zelda Breath of the Wild so far, and that's it. I mean, that's the only one that seems interesting.
And it's selling like hotcakes, because it's right now record-breaking right now for sellout game for a launch.
It's a good strategy, but
yeah. That's
like their only strategy.
Well, for now.
I mean, the next big thing is probably so far Mario Kart. And even at that, like, I already have Mario Kart on the Wii U, so I don't necessarily need it. I'm just hoping that all the deluxe stuff is going to be coming in as like some kind of downloadable package on the Wii U, because I swear to God, I don't want to pay like an entire system and an entire game just to get a freaking proper version of the battle mode in Mario Kart. I swear to God.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. What's the point of upgrading if you like what you already have?
Exactly. Let's just hope it just turns out well, I guess, for those gamers
mm-hmm.
out there. This is our fourth Oscar episode.
Mm. Mm.
We've been doing this for 3 years now, so this is our fourth one.
Yay.
And Matt, I start off by saying I'm not actually supposed to be here tonight.
Complications happen. I had original plans for a special guest to come on, and shit happened, didn't work out, and this is the backup plan, so here we are once again.
Hey, at least the important thing is that we're doing it.
Exactly.
Yeah, well, actually, my plan, my what I was particularly referring to is I didn't even see the first half of the Oscars, because I had to work, unlike these two right here.
I mean, the second half is the most important part of the Oscars. It's important.
I mean, oh, and the things that happened there. The things that happened. Ooh lally, golly, what a day.
Exactly. I mean.
Oh, this... yeah, there are some hot button topics.
Oh, very hot buttons. But let's just talk about the presentation and the host being Jimmy Kimmel. First off, because honestly, Jimmy Kimmel did a good job this year, actually.
Honestly, I feel like Jimmy Kimmel is probably the best Oscar host that we've had in a while. Because usually, I'm going to be honest, I wasn't really much of a fan in the previous years. I mean, the other times when we had Ellen DeGeneres and Chris Rock and Neil Patrick Harris, they sound like a fantastic idea on paper, but with the way that they execute it, it's just really not their best. It really felt more awkward than it is good. I mean, the previous times that they've done it, they were fantastic, but like this time around, it's just, it really kind of sucked. I mean, the best one like from the previous years was honestly Seth MacFarlane, and even at that, it's more like you got to get into Seth MacFarlane's type of humor. Like honestly, I feel like MacFarlane was better than the other ones, but Jimmy Kimmel, honestly, he was really solid this year. He really made this entertaining. I mean, sure, there are a few elements that he did bring in his talk show host components, like when he would bring in, let's see, like when he would have like a little surprise for those tourists on a bus, or like when reading those mean tweets. But other than that, like he had some great material working for him. And, like, he knows how to handle as a host and how to interact with the guests. And especially the best thing and the funniest moments, I would have to say, like, the little feud that he had with Matt Damon. Like, I will admit, like, I don't watch the Jimmy Kimmel Show, and I did hear that apparently it's kind of a thing that's going on in his show where, like, something with Matt Damon is going on. But in here, like, you do see the rivalry that's kind of going on in there. It's the best thing. And, James, you missed, like, probably one of the funniest things to happen at the Oscars in recent years, because there was at one point where it's supposed to be like this great big 20th anniversary Good Will Hunting reunion with Ben Affleck and Matt Damon. And like when they started, they came in, that like they were announced as Ben Affleck and guest. And whenever Matt Damon would try to talk, like you see Jimmy Kimmel in the orchestra pit, like playing like the, like, kind of the outro music, like, when you're done with your acceptance speech. Oh, it is amazing. It really was hilarious.
I did see that, and actually, the only thing that I can say particularly bothered me about Jimmy Kimmel's overall performance was, like you said, they have that, he has that feud going on with Matt Damon, and I don't watch Jimmy Kimmel's show. So, coming in on the second half of it, it was completely out of context, and it took me a little bit longer to get into it and realize, oh, this whole thing is just a big joke. But yeah, I recently saw a comedy special on Netflix, and it was one of their Netflix original comedy shows, you know, doing the stand-up stuff.
Yep.
I can't remember which one it is, or the guy who was supposed to headline it, because apparently he was boring as hell. But hey, put me to sleep. He starts off with a clip from Jimmy Kimmel, and he says, "This clip was years ago when I appeared on the Jimmy Kimmel Show," and Jimmy Kimmel does a line about Matt Damon, and the audience cracks up, and I realize, oh, wow. So it's not just Oscar night that they were doing this as a joke. He's been doing this as a joke for years.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
But I'm watching this comedy special after having seen the Oscars, and I'm like, okay, I'm clued in now. Okay.
Yeah, it's I occasionally watch the Jimmy Kimmel live talk show once in a while, and that feud's been going on for like 10, 11 years now. It's just all because it was like there was a show that he did, and the guests were bad. He didn't have a lot of time for guests, and he called up Matt Damon to try to show up, but he came up too late. It's like, here's Matt Damon. Oh, time's up. He kind of got a little pissed, and you know, and they just had this back and forth feud ever since Kent then. So it's complicated, but it's funny because, I mean, you gotta make fun of Matt Damon, especially I think of that clip. I think of Matt Damon and Team America World Police.
Yeah.
Matt Damon. I'm sorry. You
know, that would be amazing if the whole time Jimmy Kimmel just redubs Matt Damon's lines or just that. Like, whenever he would just speak, it was like, we are proud to be coming here at the Oscars, Matt Damon.
Oh my god, so yeah,
or no Mike, you know what should have been amazing? You know those you know those moments when they would do those inspirational things?
Yeah.
And you see a celebrity talking about like a movie that they remember. They should have got like Jimmy Kimmel should have talked about Team America World Police.
Yes.
And mentioned about the moments with Matt Damon. It's like he brings out such a wonderful performance here.
That would have been amazing because, yeah, that was the theme for that night, was an inspiration, because intercut, they had a few people talking about their movie that inspired them to get into the business somehow.
Mm-hmm. I did see some of those.
There was like Charlize Theron did one. I know Seth Rogen did one, which is one of mine, actually. It was Back to the Future.
He did Back to the Future. And I think that's it.
There was another one too, and I can't think of the guy's name. It was an actor.
I only remember those three. It was just the first one that you mentioned. There was Seth Rogen, and then there was Jimmy Kimmel.
There was four, but there was four.
I will.
So yeah.
Yeah. I will say this much about, because I didn't watch. I guess I should rephrase what I said earlier. It's not that I missed the entire first half or anything. You guys are frozen. I'm gonna wait for my connection to come back. And hey, am I still coming through?
Mm-hmm. Yep, you're good. You're okay. You're good.
Yeah, I was able to watch maybe part of the red carpet and the opening from Justin Timberlake coming in with Can't Stop the Feeling through part of Jimmy Kimmel's opening bit there. But only because, like I said, I was at work. I was on dinner break during that point. I had to go back out. And judging in terms of the execution of that, I say that he plays the crowd a little bit better, because I remember how much difficulty I had with Chris Rock last year.
Mm-hmm.
who looked like he was afraid to say anything or be there.
Well, I think the biggest thing is that you could tell Chris Rock was really holding back, because the biggest hot button topic that happened during that time was the Oscars So White controversy, which they did fix up, which we'll probably talk about a little bit later. But that was the big thing, is that he can't go into his usual extremes that he would go into, like, his stand-up bits. Like, he had to, like, he was probably told by executives to, like, really push it back.
I was probably also thinking, hey, I can't do colleges anymore. What am I doing here? But in any case, yeah, Jimmy Kimmel. What helped his performance so far at that point was he didn't particularly seem like he was on a leash or anything, like. He felt like he could say whatever he wanted to. Mm-hmm. And usually that when it comes to doing stand-up comedy, that's what you have to be able to do.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. For the rest of the first half of the Oscars, you guys have the floor.
First half of the Oscars?
I'm trying to think what else, because the opening monologue alone was amazing from Kimmel, even like when he was jabbing at Trump for a bit, that was kind of cool.
Well, I mean, because of that, I think like that's part of the reason why I kind of think like maybe this year, like, it must have been really easy to really do the writing, because like the comedy kind of is right there.
Yeah, know? It is. It's
you got like so much material that like you can pretty much fill it up with everything.
Yeah.
But in terms of the first half, what? Oh, actually, I don't know if this happened either in the first half or in the beginning of the second half. There is one moment that really did stood out for me, and that is when they sang "How Far I'll Go." That was really nice.
Oh, the best song. Presentations.
For one of the best songs.
Well, but there was a point where she got hit in the head with something.
Yeah, my parents actually noticed that when we were watching it together. We were mentioning it. It's like, yeah, the song is really nice, but she got bonked in the head.
Exactly, she got really bonked in the head. Yeah.
At least it wasn't too distracting, but no, other than that, it was still a really good performance. I mean, Aaliyah Carvalho did so amazingly in there, and also the extra addition of Lin-Manuel Miranda's performance, like the little rap number at the beginning, that was honestly really cool.
Mm-hmm.
And at that point, like, that better be online, like on YouTube or something, like to get, or like if they ever update the CD, kind of get like the updated like Oscars version of "How Far I'll Go," just to have that little verse from Lin-Manuel Miranda.
Yeah, I mean, the best song presentations were interesting. I mean, "Can't Stop the Feeling" was one of them at the beginning, but then, of course, the John Legend doing the medley of both La La Land songs were interesting.
For some reason, I don't know why, I always feel like when I hear "City of Stars," it's like we need a Randy Newman version of that.
City of Stars, how I want it. City of Stars, ba 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 ba, I am ready. Ba 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 da ba da ba 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 ba. I am ready. I am ready. Things I love anymore. Best picture. Actually, it didn't. I am ready.
But there's a bit that I've noticed in the presentation wise when Jimmy Kimmel was dropping candy from above.
Oh yeah.
He was dropping like Junior Mints, like in Red Vine from above, and there's like the little parachutes coming down, and everybody's going crazy. And then wasn't there like donuts and cookies too? And then
yeah, there was at one point like donuts fell.
Yeah, and but then they talked. She talked to one kid. I don't know who the kid was. And then he was demanding.
Oh, it was the little kid from Lion.
Ah, that's what it was. Okay, yeah, and he was asking for like some other candy, and it just came right down. It was kind of cool seeing that happening.
He reenacted the Lion King.
Yeah. Hans of Enya. Just raised the kid. Otherwise, yeah, the presentation was really nice. I mean, the theme was inspiration. It was really nice. The memoriam was decent. I mean, yeah.
Well, except for that one point, apparently they put in someone who was alive.
Yes. Yeah, there was like a person from Australia who died, and it was her friend instead who was in the picture instead of the person who died. It was just the big flub there.
Oh, in the in memoriam portion.
Yeah, that was,
I read about that.
That was a big like flub, but that I read that later on. I was like, oh, I didn't notice that. I mean,
well, it's like you wouldn't know. like you wouldn't know who this person is, really.
Unless you really, really knew the business from all over the world, you know, everybody who is in the... I mean, because most of the people who die, you don't know unless you know the business. You watch movies a lot and TV a lot.
Yeah, that's the thing is that I remember a couple of years ago, the British Oscars got came under fire. The year after Bob Hoskins and Rick Mayall passed away,
mm-hmm.
and in the BAFTA Awards when they did their in memoriam, they forgot to put them in there. And there was blowback. There was blowback because those two gentlemen are national treasures over there. But over here in America, we remembered to put Bob Hoskins in.
Mm-hmm. I mean,
and
you know the thing I noticed.
If what I'm saying is when you miss somebody, where'd Matt go?
Sorry, I just got a little dumb message. Sorry about that.
When you miss somebody, even if it's say a voice actor, did they put Joe Alasky in there?
Hold on.
No, I don't think so. Actually,
Fudge, Nabbit.
I don't think so. They didn't put in Joe Alasky on it. I don't think they do voice actors actually.
No, it's not even listed on here at all. So
it's part of the frickin' business. The guy did movies too.
Weird, yeah.
You see what I'm talking about?
You're not gonna get everybody. I mean, there's so many people that died. I mean,
and before that, you even had, Stefan Ellison, Mr. Coat, was mentioning how he was disappointed a year or so ago when they didn't put in Christine Cavanaugh.
Oh yeah.
Mm-hmm. True. You didn't this. This is the woman who voiced Babe, and you didn't put her in?
And I think I'm noticing
why,
this.
Why? Because she's a voice actor?
Another thing
Joe Alasky voiced half the Looney Tunes, so why not?
I was going to say, I know they didn't put Alan Young on the list either.
Fuck me.
I just noticed that right now. They didn't put Alan Young on the list. Guy, I think he's done more than just television. I think he's done movies, too, so I would think that would make...
Yeah...
I would think. He's had a long career. I mean, Alan Young is a legend in the biz. I mean, besides Mr. Ed.
Scrooge McDuck.
And DuckTales. I mean, I don't know. I was going to say, the other thing I noticed when watching the Oscars is the commercials. There's one commercial, it's a Rolex commercial that they played.
Mm-hmm.
And that's like the best commercial I've seen because they did all these clips with the Rolex. And then... they redeemed themselves because they showed a clip of Bill Paxton from Titanic with a Rolex. It was kind of like, hey, since they forgot to do the in memoriam because it was way too soon, there's their tribute to Bill Paxton.
Mm-hmm.
It's like, yeah, the Rolex...
I don't think that was planned.
Because he died on the day of, and Jennifer Aniston did mention him.
Yeah, that was good.
Yeah, that was really good of her to do that. I mean, she seemed really torn up about it. Like,
yeah, I mean,
like
Bill.
She's like, this just happened. Like, I have to talk about this.
Yeah, we'll have to wait till next year because I think Bill Paxton will be mentioned next year's Oscars in memoriam.
It
better be. Yeah, the 90th one.
This is the guy who gave birth to the phrase, "Game over, man. Game over."
Exactly. Besides that, I believe we can go right into the actual movies that won their Oscars, because I guess I can mention the Governor Awards they mentioned, and one of your favorite people, James, got a honorary Oscar, Jackie Chan.
Jackie Chan.
Yeah, he got
Jackie
honored.
Chan got an honorary. He got a life. It's a lifetime achievement award.
I figured I'd mention that because I was like, oh, Jackie Chan got something. But
I sort of think it's about freaking time because
exactly.
You break nearly every bone in your body committing your life to entertainment. You nearly kill yourself half a dozen times, at least. That is the level of commitment that he's had towards not just the entertainment industry in the U.S., but obviously at home, first and foremost. Mm-hmm. All over the world.
All right.
So
we are going to go through these categories and try to go with these as fast as we can. So we might as well just talk about what best visual effects. Of course, The Jungle Book.
The Jungle Book.
Shut up. I almost said the wrong thing. I caught myself. Yeah, The Jungle Book won best visual effects.
Oh, you mean that other Disney remake that's going to get the best visual effects when that comes out. Oh, yeah.
We're predicting that. We're
predicting it now.
We're predicting that the upcoming Lion King live action movie.
Oh, that Lion King. Oh.
Yeah, that one's going to win best visual effects when it comes out. God, you know, because here's the thing, like, I just watched Doctor Strange just before the Oscars, and I was, like, looking at the visual effects, I'm thinking, oh my god. Oh my god. Like, The Jungle Book is amazing, but I thought Doctor Strange should have won for the mind-bending of visual effects that they did for that movie. Like, you see things getting moved around, and it's just, like, Inception on crack.
Yeah, I'll be honest, though. Even though I haven't seen Doctor Strange, I would have to say that when it comes to The Jungle Book, it's probably the most predictable win this year.
It is.
Even more than Best Animated Feature, because it really had no competition. I mean, there are some surprise categories in there. I mean, like, you got your usual, like, Star Wars, and yep. You got your Marvel movie. Excuse me.
Kubo.
Kubo was in there, too.
But then you got Kubo, which is, I've said it before, the second ever animated feature... Well, the second ever fully animated feature to actually get a nomination for Best Visual Effects, the first being The Nightmare Before Christmas. And that is actually quite a surprise, and that did bring in an interesting twist. But, like, everyone knew that The Jungle Book would be the big winner. I mean, like, you could definitely tell right from the get-go, especially how the visual effects done in there is absolutely stunning. And considering the fact that Mowgli is the only thing in there that's real.
Mm-hmm. I mean, yeah, I do agree, because that was the most phenomenal thing, because I watched it with my mother, and she was like, wow, I can't believe that, wow, technology's been great, wow, so.
You have Shere Khan teaching wolves how to fly, how could it not win?
Mike, oh god.
That's my favorite part, that's my favorite part in the movie, he's like.
Mike, is your mother Owen Wilson?
She
that impersonation is like, wow. All these animals look like they're coming to life. Wow.
She can be, I don't know.
Wow. Look at how Baloo is swimming with Mowgli singing Bare Necessities. Wow.
So, before we move on...
Wow. Look at how King Louie has the cowbell. Wow.
Wow.
Before we move on, have you guys seen any of the movies that got nominated?
I've only seen Rogue One, Kubo, and Jungle Book.
Okay.
Yeah, I've not seen Doctor Strangelove or what the heck is Deepwater?
Deepwater is apparently the Disney movie that they kind of released and no one knew about it, so screw it.
Because the one right next to it is the best film editing, and Hacksaw Ridge won that.
I haven't seen Hacksaw Ridge.
Here's something we can comment on. Best costume design. Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them won that one.
Costume?
Yeah, best costume design.
Wait a minute. What are you looking at? I'm looking at the Oscars website. I see.
Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them won best costume design.
Okay, I'm looking for that. Oh, I mixed that up with makeup.
Yeah, never mind. We'll mention that next. But costume design went to Fantastic Beasts and Where to Find Them, which is probably the first Harry Potter related movie to get an Oscar. I don't think the previous Harry Potter movies had been nominated. So
No,
so that's
it's a rather unusual thing to be nominated for in terms of a Harry Potter film. Usually you would think of probably best visual effects and stuff like that.
Yeah. But here's the one. Okay, we'll get to this one. Here's the one that really upset everybody. Everybody was an uproar about this. Like,
oh yeah.
Best makeup and hairstyling went to Suicide Squad. People went ballistic, like, Star Trek Beyond should have won that one. But no, Suicide Squad is a Oscar-winning movie.
Suicide Squad. Okay. I see why people would be jolted by it. But keep in mind, this is not a judgment over what the content of the film is. This is a judgment over the makeup.
And hairstyling.
It has nothing to do with the execution or how the film turned out
right.
in terms of a story.
Right.
Which, to be honest with you, I did rewatch the extended cut of Suicide Squad, and I realized something. As much dopey fun as I had with the film altogether, the whole conflict revolves around them trying to fix a problem that the government lady started to begin with.
Yeah.
So that's pretty dumb.
I know.
But in any case, if you're going to go on a rant that it won an Oscar in this category, you're making the argument that the makeup is bad.
And see,
you have to make that argument, and that's no, the makeup was not bad.
Mm-hmm. It's true, because I will say the makeup and the hairstyling was really great. It made the characters come to life. But people are arguing that you would think that a movie with a lot more makeup and prosthetics for Star Trek Beyond, I mean, the aliens look like all that work got like wasted for a nom. I mean, over like simple like makeup and twisting of the hair and just white. And I'm happy.
It's not as much. It's not what you think. Those actors, no matter what, they all spend hours in the makeup chair.
Yeah,
regardless
and,
of how.
If I may, sorry, are you continuing, James?
Regardless of how little it appears to be effective, like, if it just so turns out that Margot Robbie has a white face, she probably spent a long time
mm-hmm. right.
Getting that white face.
I know. I'm just saying this like comparison between the two films because I know for a fact. Wait, back up here, because you wouldn't think a man called Ov is gonna win best makeup and hairstyling. That's like a foreign flick. So it's just like it's between Suicide Squad and Star Trek Beyond, and I just thought that was the better choice. But yeah, I can see why it won. Go ahead.
Yes.
All right. You know, the thing is that it is a little bit ridiculous that people are arguing about best hair and makeup because keep in mind, even though Suicide Squad won, you are talking about the same category that Norbit got nominated. Do you guys remember that?
Oh. Well, that was actually not a bad. That's Rick Baker. That was not a bad job there.
Yeah, exactly. So, honestly, we can all we can bash it all that we want, but James is absolutely right when he says that the makeup and hairstyling is a completely different, venue in terms of the movie. That's just, a small portion. And I have seen Suicide Squad myself, but I won't deny that, I'm not going to deny that they did a good job with it. So, it probably did deserve it. But I think what really did upset people is mostly the fact that now they have to say that Suicide Squad is an Academy Award-winning motion picture, especially considering the fact that no Marvel... What?
And the same night that it became an Academy Award-winning feature, Batman vs. Superman became a Razzie winner.
No, that was the day before.
That was the day before.
Yeah, they always...
Oh, okay.
The day before is Razzies, and then it's Oscars. No, but the thing is with, the mindset of... it's not just Suicide Squad, but a DC Cinematic Universe movie actually won an Oscar. Something in which not even Marvel ever did. Like, I asked on Twitter and on Facebook to people, and the most that I got a response is that Spider-Man 2 got an Oscar, technically, and the closest thing that Marvel ever got was actually Big Hero 6 winning for Best Animated Feature. And literally that's it.
Basically.
And that's probably the big thing that kind of upset it, especially to Marvel fans, is mostly the fact that a Marvel movie never, they did not get a single Oscar win. Like, even this year, Doctor Strange was the only Marvel movie that got an Oscar nomination. Deadpool got nothing, and Civil War got nothing.
Yeah.
So,
well, Deadpool would probably laugh it off and make fun of himself for not getting an Oscar nomination.
Honestly, so. I was actually very surprised that Deadpool did not even make an appearance at this year's Oscar.
Mm.
Like, they would do, some kind of little bit with him. That I'm surprised it didn't do.
Maybe they approached Ryan Reynolds and he turned it down.
Or, I don't know. Yeah.
No, but yeah, that's mostly the thing, is that people are just mostly upset over the fact that a DC Cinematic Universe movie got the Oscar when Marvel got none.
Yeah, because I...
In the words of Rocket Raccoon, oh, boo-hoo-hoo.
I mean, I even...
honestly, maybe people are just a little bit upset that the people who won the Oscar, they didn't go up saying, I just want to thank Martha!
Next up.
We can talk about how La La Land got the majority of the Oscars, not just six of them. Best Production Design, Best Cinematography...
I mean, that movie got freaking 14 nominations. Of course it's going to get away with a lot of them.
Best Original Song, Best Original Score, and I think the other one was Emma Stone winning for Best Actress. So, yes.
And meanwhile, Watson is there, triggered!
So, yeah, I mean, I was happy. It deserved it. Let's see. Next up, we've got Best Sound Mixing with Hacksaw Ridge. Best Sound Editing with Arrival. Let's see.
I can't argue against that, because...
We haven't... Best Animated Short Film.
Seen them.
Piper.
Oh, that is interesting. Have any of you guys seen any of the other Oscar shorts? Of the other shorts?
I'm trying to catch up with Mike here. Let's see. Pearl, Parasiter and Cigarettes, Borrowed Time, Blind Vaisha. No. It went to the Pixar short. Surprise. Yeah. Not saying it was a bad short, but
mm-hmm.
I was a little bit mixed, because as someone who has actually seen all of them, I was totally rooting for Borrowed Time.
What's that one about?
All right, no. But the thing is that Borrowed Time, you can actually go look it up online for free. It's actually extremely good. It is amazing. By the way, it's actually made at Pixar. But I wasn't upset that Piper actually won, because it's one of those animated shorts that you cannot hate it. It's way too freaking cute. That, and also the animation is so phenomenal.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
mm-hmm.
They did such a great job. And I think probably the merit, like the effort that they put into the animation in itself, that's probably the reason why it actually won. So, and well, as for the others, I honestly don't know. Like, Borrowed Time could be close second. The other ones, like Blind Vaisha, is easily the most artistic one, both in its visual style and how they like tell the story in a way, because it's supposed, like, they put it as a narrative plot about a girl where in one eye she can only see the past and in the other eye she can only see the future. And then there's another one. What was the other one? Pearl. Not too big of a fan of it. Like, it's actually it's a historical one, actually. That's a historical one, because it is the first time ever that a movie or a short or a film made for virtual reality actually got an Oscar nomination.
Oh, Pearl is a virtual reality film?
Yeah, it's made for Google Spotlight Stories. And
one of those things.
The first.
You're supposed to watch that through virtual reality.
Oh,
like this.
Yeah. Huh.
Like, I only saw it as itself. Like, I didn't use virtual reality, and meh. Honestly, I didn't care too much for it. Like, it's good, but meh. But, and then there's Parasite and Cigarettes. Holy crap. That thing is the longest. It's where everything else is like 6 to 8 minutes. Parasite and Cigarettes is like freaking 35 minutes long.
Oh.
And with that said, like, you know, it is interesting, because it is based on a true story about this guy who's living life on the edge, and then suddenly, like after a few screw-ups, he was, like, he had to go and get himself a new liver, but, like, there's, like, so many, the plot is, like, there's so many things going on, and I mean, like, you know, it's pretty crazy, I have to say. It was a crazy short, and it's actually from one of the artists who actually worked on projects like Aeon Flux, and also he did the character design for the Tron animated series.
Oh, Tron.
And he also did some music videos for the Gorillaz.
Oh, okay. Yeah, let's see here. Yeah. We've got Best Live Action Short Film. Haven't seen them. Best
The Live Action Short Film Sing. Now, how many do you think voted for that thinking it was the movie?
Ha! Sing.
The Best Live Action Short, James! Are you kidding me?
Some dumbass.
Oh, that story with the freaking koala and the animals is real?
Maybe they're like, this is the wrong category for this to be in, Chuck.
Best documentary short subject, which is The White Helmet, which is on Netflix. You can go watch that. Then you got Best Documentary Feature, which went to OJ Made in America.
Yeah, that one is weird, honestly. I don't know what's with I feel like it's a recent big trend that's going on with OJ Simpson, especially with the with the TV series that was going on,
yeah.
Like the miniseries.
Yeah.
Like the one that had, like, Cuba Gooding Jr. as OJ, and it also had John Travolta.
Yeah, I think it's...
Like, I don't know. Like, the OJ started to be pretty popular somehow. But
yeah.
I was a little bit disappointed with that. Like, that was one of the few that I actually was a bit disappointed, because, honestly, I was completely rooting for Life Animated.
Yeah, me too.
I talked to the folks afterward, and they said, yeah, they only caught snippets of, they only caught the, when that category came on, I know my mom was rooting for live animated because she's actually seen it, and we all saw it. As well, but her main complaint was that everything else outside of live animated just looked from the clips that were displayed just looked like ugly or mean-spirited movies.
Oh, like they were showing to the dark side of the world in a way.
As opposed to life animated, which is a very inspiring documentary, mm-hmm. a very feel-good documentary.
Yeah, it's understandable.
Yeah.
So.
I mean, I'm still happy over the fact that it did get nomination.
A nomination, yeah. A nomination is always good. I mean,
that's still really good.
Yeah, it's still good.
Well, you're going with an inspirational theme here, so.
Yeah, inspired.
What won? O.J. Simpson.
Best foreign language film. Now, here's the thing about this category, because the person who won that couldn't be able to go there because of the travel ban. So they had someone else read kind of like a speech offhand. I think the woman was like the first or one of the Iranian astronauts. So it was interesting hearing the speech from her voice about winning the Oscar for. You know, it was very inspirational because it's like, Donald Trump this, Donald Trump that, you know, travel ban this.
I actually read, there was someone in the comments section on my Oscar vlog, and someone actually did bring up a really good point that, mm-hmm. like, regarding the Oscar win for The Salesman, like, it's probably the one that is the most questionable if it actually legitimately won that thing instead of, like, because of the current events with Donald Trump and like the big screw up that he's doing with the travel ban. And the big thing is that like when you look at all the other award shows, they would give it to Tony what's the movie Tony Erdman, I believe? Is that the one that's nominated?
Yeah, that one. Yep, you said it right.
Yeah, that one.
The like, German one, yeah.
That was the one where in terms of best foreign picture there like it was winning awards left and right, and it's even getting an American remake.
Oh,
where
that one.
Kristen Wiig and Jack Nicholson.
Yep, that one. Yep, that's the one.
So that is kind of the big question regarding, did The Salesman legitimately win because it really was that good, or is it because of the controversies that are currently going on in the world?
That is a good question. That is a good question. Because there's also Land of Mine from Denmark, then, like I said, a man... called Av, which is the Swedish one, and then Tana, which is the Australian one. So yeah, that's a good question. But of course, let's talk about the best animated feature film, which went to Zootopia.
Yeah, boy.
Oh, boy. You know, I must have really had paid that little attention to the Oscars coming up to it because I knew I was going to miss at least half of it. I thought Finding Dory was still nominated. No, it apparently lost. It apparently got nudged out in that category so that a Disney movie, and a non-Disney movie.
Hey, to be fair, I mean, instead of a fish, you do get a turtle.
Yes, that's the alternative. You get that red turtle.
Mm-hmm.
I mean...
Yeah, and honestly, like, I'm really proud of Zootopia that it actually did win, but, I mean, this year, it was very tight. I mean, all these nominations, they all deserve to get the Oscar in their own right, rather it be... Not just Zootopia, but also Moana, Kubo and the Two Strings, such a phenomenal film. In mm-hmm. fact, like some people can even debate that the big battle could be between either Zootopia or Kubo in terms of who would be the winner. Mm-hmm. Let's see, Moana, Zootopia, My Life as a Zucchini, and The Red Turtle, all of them definitely fantastic. And personally, I would have been happy and satisfied with whoever would have won. Like, I wouldn't be pissed off if, like, one movie won over the other, you know? Like, I was really happy. Me, like, Zootopia would have been my personal choice, but, I'm just glad overall that they did get the nomination and that Zootopia also got the win, you know? Definitely deserves it. Very solid film.
Mm-hmm.
I don't know. Maybe it was because I'd just seen Kubo with the family prior to watching it, but I almost felt like that had a slight upper hand. Even though let's be honest, that's very much a typical hero's journey story. Moana, I have not seen yet, so I can't make that judgment.
Mm-hmm.
But it going to Zootopia is not really. It's Zootopia is a good movie. I can't really complain. I'm not gonna lose hair over what one painted feature.
Exactly. I'm actually, because I like Zootopia. Actually, it was really good. Actually, let's see. Combing through.
We preach every 5 minutes about the same point, and then we stick our foot in our mouth. But it's cool.
Yeah. Let's see, screenplays, which include Best Original and Best Adapted, which won Best Original for Manchester by the Sea. Okay, this is interesting. Best Original Screenplay, Manchester by the Sea. The writer of it, his previous work. Have you seen his previous work?
No, I have not.
One of his writing credits is for the Rocky and Bullwinkle movie.
Say what?
His previous writing credit, he wrote the Rocky and Bullwinkle movie.
I heard that Manchester by the Sea is a depressing as hell movie.
Exactly. So I'm trying to think, how does this writer go from Rocky and Bullwinkle to this most saddest fucking movie in the world here?
Well, it's simple. After what you did with Rocky and Bullwinkle, of course you would go in that kind of mood. To go and make something like Manchester by the Sea.
Oh, there's a lot of emotional things. But yeah, I just wanted to mention that because I thought I was looking up this writer and I was just like, his name is Kenneth Lonerga. So it's just like, it was just interesting to see his work. Best Adapted was Moonlight.
Yes.
Let's see here. Then we got actor and actor. Best supporting actress and actor.
Before Before you get into that, there's one that you kind of overlooked a little bit.
Which one?
And this is one that I do want to talk about, actually.
What?
Best original song.
Oh, you want to talk about that?
Let's talk a little bit
about that. Oh, you want to talk about that one? Okay. Because I just, like, La La Land won that. I was like, okay, fine. Okay, go ahead and talk about it. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. If I'm not gonna, I'm gonna be very honest with you guys. Out of all the Oscar winners that's going on, the one that I am disappointed the most is regarding for Best Original Song going for freaking La La Land. And although, yeah, it is nice that like the audition song won over City of Stars, there's still two of the most boring songs and like the most forgettable songs in freaking La La Land. And I definitely don't feel like it absolutely deserves it because, like, there are even more memorable songs in La La Land in itself.
And actually, the Oscar went to Cities of Stars.
What?
Actually, the Oscar went to City of Stars.
No, it didn't. It went to Audition.
No, it didn't. It went to City of Stars. Yeah,
it
did.
It's Audition.
It did. We're looking at it right
now. Yeah,
we're
looking right now. City of Stars won it.
I'm on the Oscar website. The little Oscar figure is right on City of Stars.
Yes.
Hold on a sec. No, it went to. Are you sure?
Yes. City of Stars won.
Screen share.
City of
screen share.
City of Stars won the damn thing.
Here.
Hold on a sec. Really?
How'd you remember?
I swear, I thought it was the.
Nope, it's not the other one.
Look.
Audition.
Look. There. Right.
I don't think I can get it.
Here. Right here. The Oscar win right there.
Yes, sir. Really?
Yes.
It went there.
Yes, I remember when they announced it. I was excited because it was a good song from the movie.
What the fuck of sheep? Are you freaking kidding me?
Yes.
That is garbage, man. That is pure freaking garbage.
That deserved to win over Audition because I know Emma.
Okay, but either way, both of them wouldn't. Either way, it shouldn't have won because I know that in the future, people are going to remember How Far I'll Go. People are going to remember Can't Stop the Feeling. Who the fridge is going to remember either City of Stars or Audition in the future? Seriously.
I think the pop charts would probably agree with Matt here.
Especially
with Can't Stop the Feeling, because I remember when I'll tell you guys a story here. When that song came out, I remember I was driving to work. I decided to turn on the radio, and the first thing that comes on is "Can't Stop the Feeling" when you dance, 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 girl. I get to work. I'm reshopping over in the electronics section. On the screen is playing "Can't Stop the Feeling" and you dance, 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 girl. And then when I close out of work, I sit in my car. I rev things up, have a moment to myself. And then I turn on the radio. "Can't Stop the Feeling" when you dance, 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 girl. That's why people are going to remember "Can't Stop the Feeling."
Yeah, those songs, "Can't Stop the Feeling" or "How Far I'll Go," that's going to have longevity. Who's going to remember "City of Freaking Stars" in the future? Like, who's going to be listening to that on their iPod, like, on the way to their car casually or stuff, or like somewhere in the long future? Seriously.
The guy I'm pointing at.
Yeah, but I don't know, man.
Soundtrack for the entire meeting.
Like,
he's
here's the thing. La La Land definitely deserved best cinematography. Best production design. I'll even give it that it definitely deserved best director.
Yes.
Definitely deserved that.
Best actress.
Hold on. There were two other. There are three. Wait, there's best original score and then
Emma Stone. Yep.
Okay, yeah.
Yep.
I'll give those three, but for best original song, no. Absolutely not.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
I was happy that that happened. I was so happy. I mean,
that's fine. That's fine.
I even showed my girlfriend La La Land, and she loved the movie as much as I did, and she was singing City of Stars at the end of it too. So it's got longevity.
Okay.
I don't know. I just feel equally as
so.
I just don't feel. I feel as unpleased as last year when the Oscar. What was the best original song? Like the stupid Spectre one or the James Bond one?
Writing on the Wall.
There's that really powerful Gaga song, and then there's this one dude he screwed up his performance and he ended up getting the Oscar, and had to also screwed up with his acceptance speech, saying that he's the first gay guy to get the Oscar. No, you're not, dude.
Oh, man. Supporting actor and actress. Actor being Moonlight, Mahershala Ali.
Yes.
Best supporting actress being Viola Davis for Fences. Can't say much about that.
Considering that I've seen Moonlight.
Oh, you have seen Moonlight. So how is Moonlight?
Well, I'll talk about it when we do reach
Best Picture. Okay.
But I'll say this. For Mahershala Ali, he definitely does deserve to get that Oscar. Because he was he's the first actor that we do see in the movie. And he only appears he only appears in the first act of the movie and that's it. But, excuse me, but
mm-hmm.
I gotta say, his performance is absolutely phenomenal. He was the first actor that really just grabbed my interest in this movie. Oh. It was really that good. He played more of a father figure to the main character, and it was definitely great, I must say.
Okay.
Yeah, like, he did a wonderful performance, a great, likable character. You could definitely do see a lot of his flaws, considering that he is also a drug dealer. But, no, like, he definitely delivered, like, a great, powerful performance, and you could definitely do feel the connection with him and his main character.
Okay. I mean, there was also Jeff Bridges in Hell or High Water, George's Lucas Hudge.
George
for...
Lucas. What did he get nominated for?
Shut up! I'm trying to read names, I'm sucking at pronouncing them. Lucas Hudges for Manchester by the Sea. Oh, that's the kid who was nominated for best support. No, it was some other guy, okay, for Lion, and then Michael Shannon for Nocturnal Animals.
I want to say one thing about Manchester by the Sea. Jimmy Kimmel did have one of his favorite jokes that he did was mentioning somebody from Amazon there in the audience Manchester by the Sea's
Amazon
nomination there, and he says his Oscar, if it does win, his Oscar will be sent to him in a special 2-day rush delivery. Like, you would only get that if you had Amazon Prime.
Mm-hmm.
Oh yeah.
Let's see. Best actor went to Casey Affleck for Manchester by the Sea. Best actress, of course, Emma Stone for La La Land. And then the director was Damien Chazelle for La La Land. All right,
yeah.
It's time for the big moment. It's time for the big moment that happened. Make an Oscar history forever. The big best picture flub.
Yes.
Oh my god.
I remember that moment.
That moment. Oh my god. I was like live messaging the guys.
We were chatting with each other.
We were chatting with each other. I was like reacting to it as we were just, you know, watching it, and I was like, the best reaction by far. It was up that night when I found out. It was like, what? Moonlight won instead of La La Land. What the fuck?
Oh. We were. He was freaking out, and I was just like, I was thinking, there's a certain unwritten rule, and that I can't think of any particular instances off my head, but if there's one movie that sweeps the rest of the Oscars, then, and is also nominated as Best Picture, then chances are it's not going to win Best Picture. There have always been certain unwritten rules to the Oscars. That's one.
But then again, there are exceptions, like Return of the King.
Oh, exceptions are exactly that. Exceptions. That's probably one of the few times that happened. So we get.
What about Titanic?
How many Oscars have we had? You're mentioning two.
E9.
Exactly. So.
Just eight. E9. Yeah, okay, yeah. Titanic is, oh my god, Titanic is a massive exception.
Yeah.
We got 11.
Yeah, it was kind of a big thing. But, we came across that, and when that happened, that they read the wrong movie. There was There was hell to pay, actually, for Warren Beatty. I'm surprised. I'm surprised at the gauging the reaction to everyone's reaction to the folks in particular that made the mistake of reading it off incorrectly when in fact the fault goes to whoever handed them the wrong envelope.
Yeah. No, those are the ones. No, they did get hell to pay. Actually, they actually did. They're no longer invited to the Oscars anymore. Even the Oscars themselves are rethinking about their cooperation with the company. So yeah, no, don't worry. They are getting their just desserts.
Yeah.
Well, yeah, but I mean, all over Facebook and Twitter, they were pinning it on Warren Beatty.
Yeah.
Which is kind of weird because he wasn't even the one reading the winner. He will not open.
Yeah,
the
he had a reaction. He just opened the card and is like, looking at the audience, looking at Faye Dunaway, and then looking again. And then Faye Dunaway's like, oh, come on, you. And then she shows the card to her, and then she reads it out loud without even reading the card. She just says, La La Land. And everybody starts celebrating and la.
Yeah.
And then.
Yeah, and like. Yeah, and I remember, I gotta share my moment at least
okay.
when I was. Like when I was there, because for me, I wasn't too surprised. Oh, because the thing is that you can't just give a movie 14 Oscar nominations and then suddenly just decided not to give it Best Picture. I mean, there have only been 3 movies so far, including La La Land, that actually got that record. But then suddenly that moment where it's like, no, wait, it's a mistake. Moonlight, you actually won. And I was there like, wait, what? Is this a joke? It's like, it was hard to believe at first. It's like, wait, what? Are you for real? And then suddenly, like, it continued on, and, like, Moonlight was actually the real winner here. And I was there like, oh my god! Like, holy crap! Like, they screwed it up so bad. And for someone like me, like, I would watch the Annie Awards, and often in that show, like, it does happen a little bit when they would open up the wrong envelope. But they haven't done that mistake like for the big ones. Like they didn't do that kind of mistake for like Best Animated Feature. No, they like somehow, like what really is shocking in this matter is really the fact that this is the last category after they opened up every single other envelope, and yet somehow they found a way to screw it up, to take the wrong envelope, open it, and say the wrong winner.
Oh, here we go. I'm actually going through the chat of trying to see my reaction here. But yeah, because you had a fucking job. You had two, because what happens is that there's two cases with the exact same amount of envelopes in each one on each side of the stage, and they're identical. There's two sets of these cards. And of course, Emma Stone was holding her card after she won Best Actress. So there's one card that was floating around. So one of the people handed Warren Beatty the wrong fucking card, and they just pinned it on Warren Beatty just because he read the wrong card. It was the person who handed him the card. And there was conspiracy theories, too. People were looking deep into the Oscars, and they're like, wait, who had the card before so-and-so had it? Wait, was that Leo DiCaprio? He had the card in his hand. He had the card in his hand. Was it Leo DiCaprio? Was it playing Leo DiCaprio for it? And it was weird just reading into it. It's like, dude, it's somebody who did their job wrong.
I even got some.
The next thing you know, they'll tell you that Donald Trump had something to do with it.
Actually, no. The dumbest thing is that I actually got some people who are, like, pessimistic. Or they're like, oh, that's just bullcrap. The Oscars did it on purpose just for rating purposes.
Okay. What?
Yeah, somehow they said that, oh, they just want to do that just so they could be talked about in the news, just to be popular and stuff like that.
Oh, because that's how you really want to be remembered.
Yep.
Just
make a giant screw up and like that way you can be remembered like to the public.
Okay, I found it. I found my chat. So let's see, what was I going to say? When James and I were talking about how Fences for a little bit, because Viola Davis won for Supporting Actress. He said he hated the play, blah, 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 because it's an adaptation of the play, blah, blah. And then Then I said, 7 Oscar wins, La La Land, half of the noms. And then it keeps going, and we're talking this, that, talk about Oscar wins. Then, wait, what? Eyes Wide, what the fuck? Warren, that's fucking Moonlight. And then Dan was like, did you just get pranked or something? And James was like, the what? And Morgan's having the best night because he was like laughing so hard. Oscar history right here. Wow. James says, that is a flow that will go down in history. And Morgan's having his best time showing Bob's Burgers kind of gifs and just like laughing. And James like,
show them to us, please.
So Morgan's like so excited. He was like showing that one. He's like, and then James is like, I fucking told you, Mike. You didn't say Moonlight, bitch. And then Morgan just like shows that one. Like, oh, Jesus, says Devin. And James says, I said La La Land won't win. I was right. And he shows the same, Morgan shows the same one again, just laughing crazy. Yeah. And then he says, who cares? What was it? Take, and Morgan's like, take that, Mike. And I was like, it's just an award show, guys. Maniacal laugh.
Yeah. So I guess now I could say my thoughts on Moonlight now.
Yeah.
So how was...
No, I would say that...
So, yeah, how was Moonlight? Is it really best picture worthy? Really,
yeah, it absolutely is. It definitely is worthy of a best picture. I mean, it goes into the, like, it pretty much goes into the dark life of a kid who pretty much lives in the ghetto. Like, we see like three stages of his life: when he was a kid, when he was a teenager, and then when he was an adult. Like, when we see him as a kid, like, his mother is completely neglecting him, and she does all these kinds of drugs. So the kid would go see Mahershala Ali and his girlfriend and, like, see them as, like, parental figures. And then afterwards we see him in his teenage years, where he goes to an all-black high school, and, like, he often would just get picked on, but, like, he would always stick by the side of his friend, which they have that one romantic scene that they have together. And then afterwards, like, we would see his adult life, where he's kind of a drug dealer, he's like living like the good life on the streets, and then he would reunite with that friend that he had a bit of a relationship with. And, you know, like, it's a sad, but like it can definitely have its sweet moments. But this is the kind of film where the acting definitely does shine. Like, the acting is probably the best part of this movie, especially with Mahershala Ali and everybody else in there. They've all done a fantastic job with it. And yeah, definitely just a great film overall. Like, honestly, the one thing that I really am sad about the fact that Moonlight did win Best Picture is mostly the fact that nobody's going to remember much about Moonlight, because people are just going to remember more about the controversy that happened. They'll remember more about how it got it like they'll remember more the wrong envelope controversy more than just why Moonlight legitimately won Best Picture. It's going to be like The Interview all over again. Nobody really remembers much about the movie itself, but people will absolutely remember the moment when Sony got absolutely hacked.
Mm-hmm.
Hmm.
And that whole hullabaloo happened over it.
Yeah.
Which was unnecessarily overblown.
I feel like when it comes to the Oscars, people should be aware of what the movies that are nominated. They should be watching them so they're prepared to understand why they get the awards. I mean, Moonlight definitely got the award for best everything when it comes to best picture. I mean, people are describing Moonlight as Boyhood, in a sense, when that came out, kind of like that, kind of like progression of someone's life over a period of time. Had all the notes of...
Except hopefully it's not as tedious.
So, I congratulate Moonlight for winning. I mean, La La Land won 6 of its awards, which is fine. It's kind of the same as Mad Max did last year. So it's better than nothing, I mean. But I think when thinking about Moonlight, yeah, people are probably... when people watch these awards, I want people to, like I said, watch these movies because they just know it for the Oscar history. Like, oh, they got nominated. They won instead of La La Land. It's just like, yeah, that's right. It's just like nobody's going to recognize the true power that is Moonlight. I mean, I haven't seen it yet, but I might go see it because of the glowing reviews and the Best Picture win. So, you know, anything could happen. But, yeah. That was
one of the terrific memes that that I do recall was, which I so gladly took advantage of.
Oh yes, and we'll have this forever because somebody took out whoever did the camera work in this during this moment, the camera guy, I don't know who this guy is, he zooms right into the Best Picture card.
Oh yeah.
And so
when
people
held it up.
So that picture's been taken now and people just cleared it out so people could put anything in that card. So now that's become a meme now where you could put anything in that Oscar card and just like fool people around with that. And James did James put a lot of things in that card and just like he just played around with it. I've seen other people do it too. They were like, Best Picture went to Suicide Squad, or Best Picture went to Batman v Superman. I just saw people like going crazy with that meme. So that was.
And except they didn't have the right font.
You didn't either.
Oh, well. Mine was more bio.
Oh, sure. Sure. So,
yeah, James used one that is close enough. You know, he just used Comic Sans.
It looks like handwriting.
It wasn't handwriting, though. If you look at the Oscar card closely, it's just, I think, I don't even know what the final was, but it wasn't handwriting. But, yeah, that was the Oscars this year, and it was a doozy. It was a good one, too. I mean, Jimmy Kimmel did a great job as a host. Got that blunder at the end. And some things were okay with winning. Some people are still griping over certain awards. But hey, it's always next year for awards season.
There's always next year for Justice League to win another Oscar.
Hopefully. Hopefully not. We'll see. Maybe Marvel can get its first Oscar or something next year.
Justice League won an Oscar over Guardians of the Galaxy Volume 2. Let's trigger the world.
No. That would particularly trigger Morgan, I can tell.
Oh yeah. I'm glad we're doing this without Morgan so far.
If he heard that, he'd be like,
Morgan, if you're listening to this, we love you, man. We love you.
We love you, Morgan. Oh my god.
Yeah, we love you, Morgan. So
I did that joke without thinking of you, man.
douchery. So yeah, we'll see what happens next year. Hosting for next year or
I don't know.
People want Dwayne The Rock Johnson to host it. People want The Rock to host it, Dwayne Johnson to host it, because people wanted him to sing his song from Moana when he presented that best song for. So.
Yes. Do we really want the star of the Jumanji reboot hosting the Oscars?
Oh come on! I'm optimistic.
Do we want the guy who thinks that animation is a genre?
But then again, we did bring in the guy. Here's the thing, James. If we got one of the co-stars of the, if we got one of the co-stars of the grown-up movies to be a host, then Dwayne The Rock Johnson wouldn't be a bad idea.
Okay.
Yeah.
I mean, let's
campaign. They've done worse.
I mean, let's campaign it. Come on, let's do Dwayne Johnson for a host next year. Let's do that. So yeah. Next time on the podcast, we are going to talk about King Kong and talk about his movies, because today, the recording day, or was supposed to be March 10th, August 11th, Kong Skull Island came out. We're going to talk about Kong, past, present, and even future. So stay tuned next time on Cinema Royale, where we talk about King Kong.
Here we go. Someone. finally here, performing for you. No, wrong call.
And the DK crew.
Until next time, adios amigos, and long live cinema.
See you later, dudes.
Ciao for now.
Tune in next time for Expand Dong to be feature length.
What?
It's a meme, James. Look it up. Just look up Expand Dong feature length.
I don't want to.